If you think you felt a great disturbance in the force, you're not wrong. Ed Gross and me, Mark A. Altman, have a new oral history coming out this July from St. Martin's Press. It's Secrets of the Force, the complete, uncensored, unauthorized oral history of the Star Wars saga. So wherever you buy books, audio, and video, pick it up today, pre-order, and you can learn the secrets of the Force. And don't miss our oral history of Star Trek in stores now. And of course, nobody does it better, the complete oral history of James Bond in digital, hardcover, paperback, and audio. That is all. If you're a fan of Inglourious Trekspertz, you're going to love Trekspertz Briefing Room, a new series. Trekspertz
Briefing Room? What is that?
I was about to explain, then you interrupted me. It's curated audio commentaries of classic Star Trek episodes from the original series all the way through Enterprise. You're going to love it as we explore the behind-the-scenes making of all these wonderful Star Trek episodes with cast and crew that you would never expect to hear doing audio commentaries on Star Trek.
Sounds like fun.
It will be. And you can find it on the Inglourious Trekspertz podcast feed and on the new Trekspertz Briefing podcast, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Let's go see
what's out there.
If you're a fan of the 430 movie, you'll love Best Movies Never Made, hosted by myself, Josh Miller.
And Steven Scarlatta.
Where we explore some of the greatest movies never made, like E.T. 2.
Johnny Quest.
Beetlejuice Goes Hawaiian.
And Halloween 3D.
New episodes available every other Monday, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Hey, this is Mark A. Altman, and this is A Picture is Worth a Thousand Words Week. Great cinematography. And are we excited to roll camera on this one? Because it's going to be the screen won't be able to hold it.
It's going to be luminous.
Yes. Indeed. And before
the presses.
Oh, wow.
Before we get into it, I want to introduce you to your favorite 430 movie host, Mr. Monday. It's Steve Melching.
The best boy needs a spinner.
Damn right he does.
On Tuesday, it's none other than Darren R. Dochterman.
None other. Let's just not dolly around on this one. Let's just make the shot.
Wednesday, Ashley Edward Miller.
Cinematography joke.
Placeholder cinematography joke.
And Thursday, it's Mark A. Altman. That's me. And I'm just going to point. I'm just pointing. Because every still you've ever seen of a director and a cinematographer, they're always pointing at something.
But they're all funny. Squinting. They're doing one thing with the hand, maybe pointing a little and squinting.
Which is
like,
funny because
they're doing magic.
Yeah,
it is. Close, strange, close up magic. Magic. They're like Tony J or Jeff Goldsmith.
Steady cam as she
goes. Ricky J.
Ricky J. Yeah, not Tony J. Tony J was an actor.
Yes.
Oh, well, yes, like Ricky J. Excuse me, I stand corrected. But still like Jeff Goldsmith. So, anyway, this is great. Look, it's been a long time. We're in our beginning of our fourth season, and cinematography is something, it's so important, and it has evolved. You know, people think about how the change from silent to sound was the biggest evolution of motion pictures, but really the evolution, the remarkable evolution of cinematography from black and white to color, from film and photochemicals to digital. It's been an absolutely remarkable evolution to the way that images are preserved and created for motion pictures. So this is going to be a tough one. I got to tell you, I really struggle with this.
It's such a unique art, cinematography. It's so specific. I mean, of course, there's the basis fundamentals of still photography, but when you consider motion pictures evolved from simply getting enough light to capture a moving image and the place that, you know, that dictated where they built the studios and you know, where there was plenty of year-round sunlight and, you know, a lot of the original sound stages like Méliès, sound stages in France were all glassed in so they could get daylight coming in when they weren't concerned about sound issues.
You know, cinematography isn't just crucial to making movies. I would argue that it's essential, because without it, it would be radio.
You know, Steve, it's funny you talk about that. I remember in high school, my high school was across the street from the old Vitagraph Studios.
And no
they
way.
Still had, well, they still had big, like a chimney. And, you know, Chaplin, a lot of the original people from United Artists used to film their movies. And at the time that I was in high school, they were actually filming The Cosby Show there. But it was like, it was so cool to like be in the shadow of like this legendary a place and you'd look out the window in math class and see it and imagine all the cool stuff that used to happen there.
And paying attention to math.
And not to, oh my God, no, of course not. And but and I always thought that was neat.
And of course, cinematography had to evolve from, you know, like I said, just simply capturing an image that could be projected, but to creating the whole art of it, the whole language of it, the you know, the idea behind camera motion and image size and color and you know, lighting, all those the thousand little decisions that go into, you know, what they're capturing an image of and how they do it had to be developed over decades.
I'm going to be so interested in hearing your picks today. And I have to say, I just finished the new Mike Nichols book, Mike Nichols,
A
Life.
Great. Yeah.
You read it. It's fantastic.
Absolutely.
By Mark Harris. And he talks a lot about cinematography. Because again, this is a guy who learned to direct on the stage. So when he directed his first movie, you know, Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf?
Yeah.
He, you know, really worked, had to work very closely with his DP. And even, you know, with Robert Surtees on The Graduate, it was only his second movie. It was very, you know, challenging. And
he was learning on the job.
He was learning on the job. And DPs can be your best friend or your worst enemy on a movie or a TV series. And it's really important to be able to communicate with them and also to trust them. And you can learn so much from a really good DP. And the great directors all have benefited from these great marriages, you know, these professional marriages to great DPs.
Well, I mean, the famous story with Orson Welles on Citizen Kane going, you know, Greg Toland coming in and basically, you know, putting his Oscar on the desk and said, I'd like to work on your movie. And, you know, basically he had a friend from the beginning and the story goes that Greg Toland told Welles that, look, all the mechanics of this I can teach you in a weekend. Don't worry about that. Let's just go forward and see what we can do. And the great thing is that Toland liked the fact that Welles had never, you know, been on a movie set before, and that he wanted to see what someone who had no idea what the rules were, what they would do. And I think that's one of the most, you know, brilliant collaborations that there's ever been.
I want to stop because, you know, we talk about this occasionally, things. I just want to talk about that Mike Nichols book for a second since you read it. I mean, it's unbelievable. And it's so funny because you keep thinking he's turning a corner and he's sort of like getting comfortable in his own skin. And then
it's a big roller coaster.
It's a big roller coaster. And, you know, he really... You know, it sets you up to think, oh, here's this wonderful human being who did all this great stuff. And he is such an asshole, but charming.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and he wanted to be a better person, but he just seemed like he couldn't quite
get around to it. He was too busy.
And it's a remarkable series of ups and downs. And it's funny because they go into a little bit of detail about, you know, one of his biggest misfires, that Gary Shandling movie, which I assume won't be showing up tonight. And I had just watched on HBO Max that wonderful documentary, The Zen of Being Gary Shandling, which goes into a lot of detail about that awful movie. And it's just so fascinating.
Can anyone
to
remember
hear.
The name of it?
Yeah. Well, what planet are you from?
I saw it in the theaters.
Good Lord.
And there's also a great on, you know what? This is a random way of doing it. Nick Meyer on his Facebook page said, everyone should watch this Pauline Kael documentary, and I'd been waiting for it to come out. I didn't know it was out. So I went and watched it on Amazon Prime, the Pauline Kael doc, which is good, but not great. And then it had a bunch of other things, you know, when you finish. And I'm like, oh, my God, there's a Mike Nichols documentary. There's a Hal Ashby documentary.
Right.
The John Milius one, which I'd already seen, right, which is still great. So I ended up watching a bunch of stuff. But after I watched the Mike Nichols documentary, I'm like, oh, I got to read the book. Because I also, I love Mark Harris, who did Pictures in a Revolution.
Yep.
I love him other than the fact that he's really anti-Woody Allen. But I love Mark Harris, and that book, Pictures of the Revolution, is fantastic. And I thought his Mike Nichols book is even better. And it's really interesting. Didn't you find the Scott Rudin stuff at the end very interesting? Because I read it right as all this stuff, like, not that it was coming out. Everyone knew this about Scott Rudin, that he was a big bully. So they're all, everybody's shocked, shocked. There's gambling going on here. But I mean, you know,
most of his name is Rude. So what are you going to do?
But you see, you know, the way he was with Mike Nichols, and it was so sweet. I mean, Mike Nichols was ready to give it all up, and he was too old, and Scott was nurturing him and like, please, you know, that we, you know, and did everything to make it possible for him to stay in the game. Right. And it just shows that like these stories, there's two sides to it. I'm not justifying the behavior, but I'm just saying like, no one is all awful other than Hitler, and no one is all great, you know,
other than me.
Other than you, Ashley, have you guys, Steve, you must have seen it. The ASC did this wonderful film about 15, 20 years ago called Visions of Light.
Oh, yeah.
It was all about great cinematography. What did you think of that?
Greg Workman?
Chuck Workman.
I don't know if Chuck Workman did it. I know there was, you know what there was? For the 100th anniversary of movies, remember that beautiful Chuck Workman film about the 100 years of movies?
Maybe that's what I was thinking of.
Oh.
Yeah. That was a really special. It used to play in theaters. And I used to hope to see it when it played in theaters. This is long before YouTube. It's on YouTube now.
Right.
But I used to always love watching that. It was about the time of Dance with Wolves. So this is a while ago.
I was wrong. It was Arnold Glassman and Todd McCarthy.
Oh, yeah. Todd McCarthy.
Yeah.
What do you think of Visions of Life? Because that's a really great movie about cinematography.
I honestly don't have any strong memories of it. I know I saw it, and I'm sure I liked it, but I can't speak to it.
Let me give a point of view that may not be popular. The art department does a lot of work on movies in conjunction with the cinematographer. And it truly is a partnership between the production designer and the cinematographer to get the look and feel of the movie that the director wants. 9 times out of 10, the cinematographer gets 100% credit for it and does not share with anybody because the art of cinematography is so mysterious to everybody and is so, quote, magical. And they're like wizards. No one knows what they're doing. No one knows when they look at the cinematographer what they're actually doing.
No one knows who they are or what they would do.
Right.
Well, I can see why you would say that, because the three of us who are writers, we're so used to the directors getting all the credit.
That's right. Yeah, it's exactly the same dynamic.
Well, cinematographers are also in charge of, I think, the largest number of crew members of anyone.
Well, certainly
film.
The most expensive group of crew members and equipment.
Yes.
Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah, But anyway, the point I was making about Visions of Light was the irony is this is a wonderful documentary about cinematography, but it's only in DVD. You can't get it in Blu-ray. They did not master it in high def. So it's very hard to find. And when you do find it, everything looks like crap.
Because
the first time I saw it was in Telluride, and I loved it. Right. And I got the DVD, but this is 50 years ago, right? 20 years ago, whatever. But so you can't even now really watch it and enjoy the cinematography for what it is, you know, because it really is a great trip down, you know, the history of cinema and great cinematography. So speaking of great cinematography, let's talk about some great cinematography on this week where we curate a fantasy theme week of movies with exceptional cinematography. And as always, we start on Monday with Mr. Stephen Melchick.
Well, hello there. My pick for Monday is probably not going to come as a surprise to any of you. It's an old favorite of mine. It's a movie that I've had a one sheet for hanging on my wall for over 25 years. It's the first
Oscar, isn't it?
The Oscar is the first the first one sheet I had linen backed and mounted on my wall, and it's a film that needed the technology of NASA to bring it to the big screen. And of course, I'm talking about John Alcott's work on Stanley Kubrick's Barry Lyndon.
Mark this, and come what will of it, I will fight the man who pretends the hand of Nora Brady. I'll follow him if it's into the church. I'll have his blood, or he'll have mine.
The boy must go into hiding just for a short time till matters are blown over.
That poor child has never been away from home in his life.
All clever young fellows who are free and able are hereby invited to step up.
My name is Redmond Barry.
A ruined lad. And send me to the devil.
You are a liar. You're an imposter. You're a deserter.
He seems to me little more than a common opportunist. I don't think he loves my mother at all.
A good one.
Which is one of my favorites. One of my favorites. I've always loved it. That movie had a bad rap for a long time of being slow and dull. And I just never saw that. I think, oddly enough, the first time I saw it was on television. I think I stumbled across it on Bravo or something on cable years ago. And it was one of those Kubrick films that slipped through the cracks that I hadn't had a chance to see. And I was just captivated by it. And it became one of those movies that I would settle on every time I was flipping channels and came across it. And of course, since then, had got the Laserdisc and the DVDs and the Blu-rays, and I've seen it projected many times. And it is just a ravishingly beautiful film that was... clearly, I think the idea behind it was to give it a very painterly feel of its time, very naturalistic. The compositions are just pristine and immaculate. They look like paintings from the era, the way the actors are placed in the frame. And Kubrick and Alcott do all these great camera moves, these zooms in and out, where it gives you the sense of you're looking at a painting and focusing in on a detail of it, or focusing on a detail and pulling out to see the figures in the environment. Right. And it's just gorgeous. I mean, the famous story is they wanted to shoot the interior scenes by candlelight alone, mm-hmm. without the addition of without using additional artificial light. And that's true in large extent. They did use these very high-speed lenses that were developed by NASA in order to capture those images. They did use reflectors and things like that to help enhance the candlelight. But those scenes actually were filmed in candlelight. But that's not to say they didn't use plenty of other lighting and tricks in the rest of the movie. They shot the movie in its entirety on location. They didn't build any sets. So every scene of the film was filmed in an actual location, in an actual place, and they would put, scrims and filters and gels and all kinds of things over the windows, and used artificial lighting to control those environments. Because of course Kubrick is also famous for doing a great number of takes, and you need to have control of your environment if you're doing that many takes, so that when you get into the editing room, things will match lighting wise if you're using natural lighting. And Alcott won the Oscar and the BAFTA for his work on the film. And John Alcott, of course, famously was also the cinematographer on 2001, Clockwork Orange, The Shining. Worked with Kubrick a lot. I believe he was originally going to be the cinematographer on the first Star Wars film, and was initially hired, but then dropped out to work with a director he had worked with before on another project. And then the other Jeffrey Unsworth.
No.
I believe
no, Gil Taylor.
Gil Taylor.
Gil Taylor, yeah. Who you know, famously did not get along with Lucas. But boy, they created magic together, didn't they?
Well, maybe I'm mixing up John Alcott and Jeffrey Unsworth. Unsworth was the first one, yeah. My mistake.
It's all right.
But we've corrected. We've caught it. But anyway, it's just a gorgeous film. And it is definitely a film that is probably best known for its cinematography. And it certainly was an iconic entry in Kubrick's filmography.
That's such a great pick. It's such a great pick that it was close to the top of my list. And I'm really glad you picked it, because I was struggling to narrow it down as often as my problem. It's an extraordinary film. I remember the day Kubrick died. I'd never seen it. I went to our good friend Dan Weber's house and we watched Barry Lyndon. And truly, we were all the same then. And
was his TV properly adjusted?
I sure hope so. It was beautiful. It was
wow. You had this by 99. You had not seen Barry
Lyndon? Had not. That was one of the only Kubrick movie that I had not seen.
Well, it's not one of those that plays at retrospectives a lot. At least at the time, it didn't, because it wasn't one of his more popular films.
Yeah. Yeah, no, and I fell in love with it that day. I've seen it theatrically since, but absolutely just a stunningly beautiful movie. It's one of my favorite Kubrick films, and what a great pick, because, of course, the cinematography, as impeccable as the cinematography is in virtually every Kubrick film, that film is just, as you say, because of the practical locations, shooting in natural light and candlelight, it's just the perfect film for cinematography week. So that brings us. So say we all. So let's bring that brings us Tuesday and Darren Dochterman.
Well, Tuesday, I had several ideas for what Tuesday was going to be, but then I finally realized that there's one film that. I am not necessarily in love with it for entertainment's sake, but I love watching it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because again, every frame is beautiful and colorful and amazing and rich and full of everything you want a movie to be.
It's Herbie Goes Bananas, right?
Darn it, how did you know?
Herbie Goes Bananas.
No. In fact, it was nominated for 9 Oscars, and it won all of them. And it was from 1987. It is Bernardo Bertolucci's The Last Emperor.
Yes.
I have decided that you will be the new lord of 10,000 years. You will be the son of heaven.
At the age of 3, he ascended to the dragon throne. As a boy, he was the absolute ruler of Imperial China.
Stop! The emperor will walk.
His life filled with sights and sounds no other human being on Earth could experience.
I think the Emperor is the loneliest boy on Earth.
I want a modern wife, Johnston, who speaks English and French, and who can dance the quick step.
As a man, he became its captive.
I do not want to escape anymore. I want to rule.
A victim of its violent history.
I stop!
I am accused of being a traitor, a collaborator, and a counter-revolutionary.
It is not an accusation!
A prisoner of his own power.
Do you think a man can become emperor again?
Yes.
The Japanese, they are getting closer to him every day.
He was Pu Yi, lord of 10,000 years.
10,000 years!
The last emperor. Bernardo Bertolucci's The Last Emperor.
Uh, with amazing cinematography. Hold on, he's here.
Storaro, right?
Yes, Vittorio Storaro.
Yeah.
It's every frame is again a painting. It's so I think lush is the word for it. These amazingly, I mean, to our Western eyes, these alien settings, basically, that look so opulent and beautiful and sometimes ancient, and yet it feels so real. It almost feels like you're home for some reason, even though you've never been there before. It has such an enveloping sense to it that you are completely bound into this world that you're watching. And you go along with Henry Puyi on his journey, and you are him, basically. And you experience his life at various stages of his life. And each of the stages looks slightly different in tone. It's like, you know, and four or five different films that are going on at the same time. It's so well done and so beautiful and so lyrical in every image that I just can't forget the images that are in it. I mean, even in the trailer shows maybe, you know, 10 or 12 shots. All of them are amazing. So it's just something that I never forgot seeing in a, you know, large 70 millimeter presentation. And is absolutely gorgeous. And, you know, Storaro is a master.
I want to say that's one of the films, I saw that at USC when I was in film school there. And that's one of the first films that really made me think about cinematography because it's so gorgeous.
Yeah.
And I that's a great pick. I love that. I actually really like that movie as a movie as well. Yeah. And I just watched it last year, the Criterion Blu-ray of it last year, which is wonderful. And I got to visit Beijing a few years back and got to go to the Forbidden City. This was the first movie to ever film in the Forbidden City. And being able to walk around that place, it was incredible. And of course, all I could think of was this movie, which had always made such a big impression on me as well.
And I'm sure you were grateful that your organs weren't in a box.
Aren't we all?
You know, it's funny. It's such a great pick because this is a movie that I saw when it opened theatrically, loved it, thought it was brilliant. Have never watched it since. And yeah, and so I you know, you talking about it like this and Steve amplifying what you said, it makes me want to watch the movie again, which is good. What I love about this show.
I think that's the intent of the 4:30 movie.
Yeah, I know, absolutely. God, could you imagine this actually airing on the 4:30 movie? How washed out it would be
It would be on the 4:30 movie, it would have to be stripped over 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the great irony of cinematography week. Any of these movies would just look terrible on, you know, Tuesday afternoon, you know, over broadcast on a 19-inch color screen. The rabbit ear antenna.
Yeah, but it's a really wonderful pick.
I like it.
It's a terrific. I don't know. I always really liked it. It's a great epic story of this kid's journey from childhood.
It's a great epic environment surrounding a very personal story.
Yeah,
which is a lovely combination for me.
Ancient Chinese secret, huh?
You're darn right.
Yeah. But I will tell you, look, Storaro, I'm so glad to see him represented because I'm not going to pick him for Apocalypse Now only because we had Apocalypse Now previously on the show.
Yeah.
But he's like one of my absolute favorite
DPs. Although, you know what? We're in the fourth season of the 4:30 movie. I think we can start repeating.
No, you know what? That's your choice, mister. Because here's the thing. This is such a hard category that at least it took some of the weight off my shoulders to say, oh, I can't pick that because it was on the show before.
Right.
Like, it did me a favor, actually, because otherwise I was going to be completely lost, you know, and I said, oh, well, no, we've had that on the show before. I can't go with that. I can't go
with
that.
Whatever, lost.
I have two other Storaro movies on my short list as well, so.
Cool, I can't wait to hear them Friday.
For Friday. Terrific.
Yeah. Okay. Well, a great pick, Last Emperor for Tuesday. So that brings us to Wednesday. And Ashley, he's already laughing. Oh, God. We're in trouble.
It's Piranha 2, you guys.
The spawning. Get it right. The spawning.
No, I'm kidding. So let me kind of set the stage for you. It is 1977. Movie comes out. It is unlike anything anyone has ever seen before, with just really amazing art direction. It's incredibly beautiful. It's got images that you'd never thought about, and a soundtrack a score that people are talking about to this day. Now, you might think, what could Ashley possibly be about to suggest that we watch on Wednesday for Cinematography Week?
Can we guess?
Yeah, go ahead and guess.
Oh, do I have to write it down or what can I say?
If you guys want to write it down and then say,
okay,
you
can write it down. Yeah,
everybody write it down. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Because we're going to turn this into the game show network.
Is now once on Wednesday. Ashley does Wednesday.
Okay, I got my pick. I'm locked in.
Me too. Ding, 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 ding. I think it's safe to say it's not Damnation Alley. Would that be correct?
It's not, although that would be amazing.
Okay, yeah. I got mine.
I got mine too.
Okay, let's go.
Oh, I just realized I made a mistake, but I'm going to stick.
It's too late now. We're all the same now. Okay.
Go for it.
Ready? Who? Okay.
What do you got? I can't read it.
I got Saturday Night Fever.
I got Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
I got Sorcerer, but I think it's Close Encounters.
Oh my God, guys. That by the way, you just programmed an amazing week.
It's 1977. Saturday Night Fever.
Sorcerer, and Close Encounters of the Third Kind. What kind of fucked up week is that?
But I'm going to watch it. For Friday.
All of them have great cinematography. Yeah.
They do, actually. I would say especially Sorcerer. But that's not what I'm picking. Okay, so my pick is Dario Argento's Suspiria.
Roses are red. Violets are blue, but the iris is the flower that will mean the end of it.
Suspiria! You can run from Suspiria. Suspiria! You can hide from Suspiria. Suspiria. But you cannot escape Suspiria. The only thing more terrifying than the last 12 minutes of Suspiria are the first 92.
His famous groundbreaking giallo film that was shot by Luciano Tavoli. And it is notable, first of all, as a film, it's notable for being completely goddamn bananas. The plot is actually dirt simple. A young ballerina travels to Europe from America to join a ballet company. And first warning should be that the school is located on Escherstrasse, right? Which is, of course, that place is going to be screwed up. And what she encounters is a series of murders, basically of girls who don't quite make the cut, and suggestions that there are occult forces at work in the school. And there's an amazing antagonist, Mater Suspirium, who has the best name, right? Mater Suspirium, the mother of sighs. I mean, how badass is that? Look, Darth Vader sounds cool, but the mother of sighs? Are you kidding me? Like, when she's a witch who freaking kills you? But we're here to talk about the cinematography. Now, it was interesting to me when Darren brought up the importance of art design, right? And how the art department, how the production design can really affect the cinematography. And that's incredibly true here. You can't really separate in Suspiria What's really special about it, like you can't truly separate the cinematography from what's happening in the production design, except in some really interesting ways. But what we most associate with it visually is the use of color, these incredibly bright reds and blues and greens. And it's sort of set in a world where in the day when you're outside and everything is fine, the colors are very muted, right? And it just seems like it's a normal film. But as night falls, as we get closer to the danger, the colors become brighter. They become more vivid. They tell us something. Now, Tavli will tell you that he actually had a scheme in mind for when things were red and when they were blue and when they were green. It doesn't necessarily hold up when you watch it. But it's still incredibly effective because it's unsettling. And when you take it in combination with the very kind of German expressionist set design, right, which is like, you know, and I this is literally true, Technicolor, you know, Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, because it was actually shot in Technicolor, anamorphic Technicolor, and it's beautiful. It really kind of takes advantage of the space, of the lines, of the angles, creates this sense of how small our characters can be in this space, how strange it is. It's like David Lynch before David Lynch even knew that he was David Lynch. On a technical perspective, what's cool about it and how Argento used the Technicolor process is, and Darren, I'm sure, can weigh in and like talk at length about technically like how this works, but for those of you playing at home, in Technicolor, you've got red, you've got blue, you've got green. And when they developed the film, they used the reds and the blues and the greens to different degrees to amp the color that they had created in the production design for the film. And it's really fascinating. Just first of all, watching the movie, it's really sort of weird and scary and, you know, it's just kind of unsettling. It has this amazing and groundbreaking score by Goblin, which is just omnipresent and awesome. But it's highly, like, I highly recommend it. It's incredibly worth a watch, whether you're a horror person or not. Just to see this incredible visual experiment, and actually, it's not just a visual experiment. It's like an experiment in the visuals and the music, and nobody had ever seen anything quite like it before, especially in horror, at least in color. Suspiria, man, Dario Argento, 1977, completely awesome. Not the best acted movie in the world. You will not be satisfied by the plot or any of that other crap. You know, these are not like the most, like, you know, rich, you know, characters with these amazing interior lives, but it will absolutely pull you in and hold you until the end. And it's beautiful.
What an eclectic group of movies. And I say that actually in a very proud way. I'm proud of our little show. I think that so far, this is like a remarkably eclectic and well-chosen group of films, you know?
Kind of like Saturday Night Fever and...
Well, so, you know, once again, it comes down to me ruining everything. So,
and then you've got to spoil it all by saying something stupid like Suspiria. Yeah. No.
Well, no, there are a couple of things. I told you I really struggle with this because there's so many great options. So, you know, one of the first things I eliminated were films that we have picked before. So, like, James Wong Howe for Sweet Smell Success was gone, you know. I eliminated Gordy Willis for Godfather Part Two because we had chosen The Godfather. Like, close enough. Right. You know, Greg Toland for Citizen Kane, you know, because we had picked that before. So, a lot of these films got eliminated. That helped me get it down to about 1,000. Okay, then... you know, at Apocalypse Now, obviously. So then I decided, I felt it was much harder to be a great cinematographer in the photochemical world than in today's digital world with DIs and things, which may or may not be true, but that's the way I looked at it because I needed help. So like stuff like Roger Deakins in 1917, which was shot digitally, you know, I eliminated for that reason and a couple of other films. you know, and I wanted to stick with films that were in the photochemical space, you know, which again got me down to about 500 movies. So I really struggled with this because there's some true classics, you know, that I think would be on any list of great cinematography and great cinematographers as well. And, you know, it's kind of like, how can we not go with like a Michael Chapman for Raging Bull or Taxi Driver? You know, how can we not, you know, French Connection's been on the show before, you know, Jaws has been on the show. So there are things, you know, I love Caleb Deschanel, but The Natural's been on the show. The Right Stuff hasn't. Has it? No, The Right Stuff has.
Too. No, I'm pretty sure I've picked
The Right Stuff.
Yeah, so Caleb Deschanel's another one of my favorite cinematographers. Absolutely. You know, as is Alan Davio. And, you know, there are a couple of his films have been on here, but things like Empire of the Sun and Avalon and Bugsy weren't, which are all gorgeous movies.
Yeah.
But okay, I'm going to tell you what my pick is. And God, it's a struggle because I realized that we had not picked Chinatown. We talked about it when we talked about movies that are famous, that are, you know, classics that for whatever reason we don't love. And you know, again, I don't want to embarrass Steve. So I said Mean Streets, you know, you, Jay, Ashley, you said 2001, right?
Yeah.
And Darren, what did you say?
You remember? I believe I said Casablanca.
Yeah, you did.
You said Casablanca, yeah. Right? We're still talking.
Thing I never heard anybody say, but yeah.
I know. And I know Ashley Miller, and that's still the most insane thing.
Look,
and then
it's Steve the favorite mentioned. Of writers. It's the favorite of writers.
And immigrants.
And like
and
I
think, people
like,
who love movies.
And people who like to wait. And wait.
Chinatown, Chinatown is a great movie. It's a masterpiece. I just don't enjoy it.
We get that, and we acknowledge that, and we appreciate that. What I was saying that we never picked it, and of course John Alonzo's cinematography for that, and most famously Star Trek Generations is brilliant. I got
to work with John Alonzo, by the way.
Did you really? On what picture? Yeah.
On a TV show on the World War II when there were giants miniseries on NBC. With Bob Hoskins as
Churchill, no. Yeah,
John Lithgow as FDR,
wow,
and Michael Caine as Michael Caine.
Michael Caine was Stalin.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was amazing. It was weird, but it was amazing.
Yeah. I have a whole new appreciation.
John Alonzo did that.
Wow. Well, so anyway. This is what I'm going to say. I know it's going to make my wife is not going to be talking to me that I'm not picking Chinatown. I'm hoping we do a Nicholson week or we do Detective week or, you know, just because it's so, I mean, it's like, I can't believe I'm passing on Chinatown.
Well,
I just
can't, you know,
believe
what happens
it.
To nosy boys.
Yeah, exactly. So my pick, because I don't see this showing up in any other week. So I'm making this, whereas Chinatown I could see very comfortably fitting into a lot of other weeks. Same thing with Manhattan, with Gordy Willis's Manhattan, which is a stunning, you know, I could easily have, that could have been my pick. Everybody go, oh, Mark picks another Woody Allen movie. So I didn't, even though I think it's gorgeous. This is my pick. The great cinematographer John Alton did a B-movie called T-Men.
What's your game?
What's yours? We'd like to know what you were trying to pull at the club trim then.
I don't follow you.
No. A little trick of folding money a certain way.
Where'd you pick that up?
Where'd you get the lowdown on the Trinidad? Schemer, Tony?
I read it in a book.
You don't know any schemer, huh?
I can't hear a thing you're saying.
You hear any better now?
noir, one of the three famous noirs that Anthony Mann directed before he went off and did all his famous Western. Now, a lot of people would say Altman's probably a crowning jewel of the noir era was The Big Combo. And they might be right. But T-Men, as Steve, I'm sure, will attest when I'm finished talking about it, is one of these mock, not mockumentaries, but like documentaries of the era about these treasury agents that are investigating counterfeit bills. And
so they're not G-Men, they're T-Men.
They're T-Men. Right. They're T-Men.
Treasury,
they're
treasury
right. agents. And, you know, it kind of has this, like, you know, you were there. And, of course, it starts with that, like, Jack Webb title. These are the treasury agents who keep America's currency safe, you know, that kind of stuff. But it is so brilliantly shot. And again, John Altman, who shot it, wrote probably the first book on cinematography called Painting with Light, which is probably one of the most famous books about cinematography. And he later went on and did a lot of famous movies like Father of the Bride. And, of course, he did American in Paris, the dance sequence in American in Paris, won an Oscar for it. But his noir work is impeccable. And, again, a lot of people who may not know the movie, they know that shot from The Big Combo of Robert Conti standing in the at the airport inside this hangar. And there's all the shadow and smoke. And it's like one of these really iconic images of noir. But T-Men, there's this murder in a sauna that's a fantastic. And June Lockhart is in it. She plays the wife of one of the T-Men. And he's undercover. And she runs into him. And she has to pretend she doesn't know him because she knows he's undercover. And at first, she's like, hey, where were you been? And he's like, and then she has to backtrack and go along with this thing. It's so great. It's so great. It's so wildly entertaining, and partially the reason that this really, like, now it would be like a third-rate procedural, that it works and it's so well done is because the cinematography elevates it and makes it something special when everything about it, the performances, the direction, certainly the story and the writing, you know, are all B. But the A-list cinematography makes it just a fantastic movie. And to me, like, that's why I'm picking that as opposed to the many other options that I could have gone with. Plus, I think I saw John Altman speak at Telluride, and he's one of these, I guess in Yiddish they call them alter cockers, you know, but he was this cranky old guy who quit the business because he couldn't stand the bullshit, you know, and he was just so great, you know, even his 80s and 90s, just this. Did not suffer fools. Like all these great DPs in the old school, like when you see Bogdanovich interview John Ford, you know, just like basically like look like they could kill you with a look. And because they could. So anyway, so my pick for Thursday is the Anthony Mann movie directed by director of cinematography is John Altman, and the movie is T-Men. They did a couple of movies together. He Walked Alone, which I don't love. Raw Deal, which is pretty good too, but
is that
it's
the
not
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
No, but it's not as good
bake
as T-Men.
You a cake.
You should not drink and bake.
And bake.
What do you
I
think,
love
Steve?
That you can do a quote from Raw Deal.
Because Steve,
I saw it at Noir Week at the American Cinema Tech.
I think you might have. And I think we might have done Movies You Haven't Seen Week at your house once. We all brought movies we love that you
like
probably
Hidden Treasures or something. Yeah.
Something like that. And I brought T-Men.
Yeah. Huh. Yeah, no, I remember it being a fun movie that looked great. I don't have a lot of other strong memories of it, to be honest.
No, it's there's so many great set pieces in it. And like I said, the murder in the sauna, because this is his character. Schemer, that's his name. The bad guy, the henchman's name is Schemer. You know, it's like it has
when
that
you name
kind
a
of,
kid that, you sort of
you know
give
what you're
him
gonna
his,
get.
His future. So,
and it has Charles McGraw as a villain who I always love. He's a good guy in Narrow Margin, but he's always, you know, one of these great villains. And so he's in it. And, you know, it has this fun cast and, you know, totally unpretentious noir. But, you know, I love that era of the house of 92nd Street, you know, with the voice of God telling us, you know, the Lord's work that the federal government is doing to keep us safe. It's, you know, it's always so much fun. And the T-Men is no exception. So anyway, that's my pick, which, of course, then brings us to Friday. which is, you know, the blood is on the wall. But I think I got something that we may all be able to agree on. Should I go straight to the one that it should be?
If you can.
I mean, you may disagree.
If you have the courage.
I have the courage, I think. It's David Lean's epic, Lawrence of Arabia. And the DP, of course, was the great Freddie Young. I feel like, you know, any movie, you know, any week where we're going to honor great cinematography, I mean, this should be top of the list.
Have we done Lawrence of Arabia?
I don't think we have. I looked at a list this morning, but it was only, went up to...
It's not on my list. Wow.
My list ended somewhere at the early third season, but I don't recall.
We have not. We have not picked Lawrence of Arabia, and obviously that's a great pick. I remember holding out to see that movie for the first time when that great restoration was done by what's his name? Mark Harris?
No, Robert Harris.
Robert Harris. They showed it at the ABC Entertainment Complex Center, Century City. That's no longer there. Seeing it in the restored 70mm was spectacular.
Yeah, it's an almost
you know, little pick.
I have to say something that I don't.
Oh shit!
I wouldn't put it in the amazing cinematography folder. Because most of it is shot outside.
Yeah.
In the desert, yeah. And honestly, it's a lot easier to light stuff outside.
You're saying you cheated because God did the lighting?
Yeah.
Oh, but I'm
pretty sure you can make a movie in the desert look like shit.
And the composition, you ever see Ishtar?
But the compositions are not the cinematographer. The compositions are the director.
Well, that depends who the director is.
It does. But with David Lean, I guarantee you, him.
Okay.
Well, you're also, you're picking your film stock and, you're using reflectors and, there's a lot of other decisions.
Of course. But I'm saying that when I think of, I love Lawrence of Arabia. Okay. It is one of my favorite films of all time. But I don't think of it as great cinematographer. That's all.
Yeah. Okay. Well, okay. So we have one person who doesn't share our enthusiasm.
I don't.
So for this pick. So
I don't share that.
We need to continue. That. What about Russell Mattie for A Touch of Evil?
I think that's another gorgeous movie.
I know a lot of it was shot outside, but.
Yeah, but it was shot outside at night.
It's black and white. There's
a Tuesday. Tuesday.
Only two colors, black and white. So it's easier.
Okay, how about Vimo Sigmund for McCabe and Mrs. Miller?
Directed by the great Robert Altman. That was on my list. That is a gorgeous looking movie. I meant to watch it before this week, but there are several Vilmo Sigmund movies on my list, including that one, which is terrific. Another one that I did watch this last week was Heaven's Gate. I watched the director's cut of Heaven's Gate, which is gorgeous. Vilmo Sigmund.
Vilmo Sigmund.
Of course.
No. Well, I'd have to recuse myself from anything that has the name Miller in it.
So I got to tell you,
Miller's Gate, Crossing.
Miller's Crossing, by the way, Barry Sonnenfeld. And Miller's Crossing was on my list, but of course I picked that for Gangster Week.
Right.
So I didn't include that, but that is also one of the best looking movies of all time as well. I mean, Barry Sonnenfeld, before he became a director, was an amazing cinematographer.
Yep. In fact, maybe that's
Blood Simple. Heaven's Gate's audacious. I have to give you credit for that.
I agree.
That's a fucking ballsy choice.
And that, you know what? Heaven's Gate, that's the entire week. You would need all 5 days for that movie.
Just to watch it.
It's over 3 hours.
And it also might be the only time we would ever suggest Heaven's Gate.
But if we're going to put Heaven's Gate in contention.
You could also stop watching it after an hour and a half.
That's true.
I actually like Heaven's Gate. I really like Heaven's Gate. What about Once Upon a Time in the West?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Antonio Dali, I can't pronounce his name, Coley.
Use your words.
You're my Italian. I can say calzone, but I can't pronounce this crazy piece name.
Calzone.
Italian to Michael.
My other Vittorio Storaro. My other Storaro so movie.
Yeah, it's Storaro.
Besides, you mentioned Apocalypse Now, was Il Conformista, The Conformist. The
Conformist.
Which is a gorgeous movie that I've been wanting to rewatch for years. I don't know if it's out on high definition or not, but I loved it back in the day, and it is.
I think it's on the Criterion Channel. I think it is.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to nominate a crowd pleaser choice for Friday.
A crowd pleaser.
Yes, and it's funny because I don't really. I guess it's kind of like Heaven's Gate because I don't really love the movie. I think it's okay, but I think it's. But there's a reason why I think it's interesting.
Lawrence of Arabia.
No, Avatar. And the reason why is because, look, I don't love that movie at all. It's like going into a candle store for 3 hours, okay?
It's
like,
all digital. It's all done in post.
Yes, it is. But what I think is interesting about it as an exercise in 3D is how different it is from so many other movies that were like, you know, shot for 3D or then transferred to 3D, where everything is always sort of coming at your face. And I oh my God, did I just say that?
By that logic, why don't we go coming at
you? What I think is interesting about the way that it's shot that makes it unique is how he creates depth in that movie, which I think is really fascinating and really beautiful. So what just depth? As a technical
exercise, I go with the Abyss over Avatar.
I mean, look, I love The Abyss, but I wouldn't put The Abyss in this category for the same reason.
The
right?
Abyss because is a black and white movie, although the black is blue.
Yes, that's true.
See, as much as I love James Cameron's films, I love them for the storytelling and the direction. And I feel like his cinematography tends to be more, I guess, I don't know, it sounds bad, but workmanlike. You know, it does the job it needs to do. It's not particularly artistic.
I'd have to agree with that, too. But the main thing is that most of the shots in Avatar have never been through a camera.
I know. That's what I'm saying. It's all done in the digital world. So Darren,
that's a good question, though. Does that count?
Digital cinematography.
Well, apparently it did to the Oscars because the Lord of the Rings won. And if you look at the raw footage for that before they did the DI on it, not very impressive.
Yeah, right. I don't agree with the Lord of the Rings getting best cinematography.
Yeah, I don't either.
Yeah,
there were better movies that were more deserving.
But what I would suggest for if we're going to talk about a big visual effects movie that has beautiful cinematography, then you got to go with Blade Runner.
Yeah, well, that's true.
Because Blade Runner carries it in both worlds, in the visual effects world and the live action world, because that is a gorgeous movie.
I mean, almost Alien, almost by the same token.
And Blade Runner 2049, I think, is stunningly beautiful as well.
Because it's Roger Deakins.
Yeah. Who we haven't talked about at all this week, which is strange.
Because we suck. Because Roger Deakins is a freaking cinematic god.
He is a god.
And has a great podcast.
If we want one from Roger Deakins, how about The Shawshank Redemption?
Well, how about Assassination of Jesse James, which is amazing. And, you know, that may fall within your Last Emperor.
Gerald Ford.
That might fall under your whole Last Emperor. Like, you don't love the movie, but you love the cinematography.
Yeah.
I actually love the movie, too, but it's one of the most beautiful-looking movies of the last 20 years. I mean, everything Deakins does. I mean, look at Skyfall. Look how he elevated the Bond movie with that.
Oh my God! Just the fight alone, like in the tower in Hong Kong, that's all like in silhouette is amazing.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
And
most of that is visual effects, actually.
And to Darren's that was all point,
damn it, Darren, stop it.
He's very involved in not only art department but costume and wardrobe.
Absolutely.
Deakins, you know, to create that color cut. By the way, what about your buddy Ernie Haller, who directed the second Star Trek pilot, but is more famous for having done Gone with the Wind?
Whose buddy?
Ernie Haller, your buddy.
Your buddy,
Darren. He directed Where No Man Has Gone Before.
I don't know him.
I know, but he did a Star Trek. Star Trek.
Just because someone does a Star Trek doesn't make them my buddy, Mark.
Dane Rescher. What about Dane Rescher for Star Trek 2?
Let's not. Although
Richard Klein. Richard Klein for Star Trek The Motion Picture.
Absolutely.
Now, but if you want to go crowd pleaser, although this this one has definitely been through the digital mill, but it was spectacularly beautiful, I think, is Mad Max Fury Road.
Yeah, that's true. You know what's special about Mad Max Fury Road? It was the first movie I saw in focus in 15 years. Because I was not wearing glasses to the movies, and like I was just lazy because I didn't have any. And finally, I said, "Fuck it!" It just got so bad that I went to the eye doctor. I got glasses, and the first movie that I saw after I got glasses was Mad Max Fury Road. I remember sitting down, I pulled my glasses on,
and your glasses like, broke during the movie.
Oh my god! time enough at last. I almost cried because I was like, my God, this is what movies look like in focus. They've been out of focus for 15 years.
I was blind and now I can see.
When we do Best Optometry Week, that's a new one.
But it's a beautiful film. It really is. Whether it's in focus or out of focus like everything else.
Yeah. What about Darius Kanji for Seven? That is also a film that reminded you of what a great cinematographer could do, and particularly in concert with an amazing director. I mean, the marriage of Kanji and David Fincher was pretty spectacular in Seven.
Yeah, absolutely.
I won't.
I think they're muted. But there's another cinematographer that's done a lot of great work recently, Emmanuel Lubezki, who did Tree of Life, Children of Men, and The Revenant, all beautiful films.
Yeah, absolutely. Children of Men also has that remarkable shot, and it has Michael Caine. So that's another thing.
Michael Caine.
The Last Picture Show. The Last Picture Show. Mm-hmm. Robert Surtees.
Well, and gorgeous, also The Graduate, which is stunning. But you know, when I was looking for movies that I felt cinematography really enhanced, that weren't just great movies, I looked at Michael Sarrazin for Angel Heart. Like, I love the look of Angel Heart. I think that's a really because it was neo-noir. It took film noir, but did it in color without, I think that's remarkable. I mean, again, Chinatown did that. So I would come back to Chinatown and say, John Alonso in Chinatown, what a beautiful looking movie. And I understand your reservations that it doesn't have the resonance for you, Steve, that it has, but I'm sure that even, you know, you would agree that it's a beautifully shot and movie.
Would you not agree, sir?
I would.
Don't wait for the translation.
Answer me. Angel Heart. I watched Angel Heart last year for the first time in years, and gorgeous.
Isn't it? I'm all this stuff in Harlem, and then in New Orleans, and then he goes up north. I mean, Angel Heart's a movie that has never gotten the love it deserves. I've said this before on the show, and we still never picked it, but it's never gotten the love that movie deserves.
Even in Satan Week, we didn't.
Yeah,
hold on. I know.
That was a big shot. And
Alan Parker died last year, and it's like, look at those movies. Fame, The Wall, Angel Heart, not Bugsy Malone, but, you know, Mississippi Burning is a beautiful looking movie. He was such a great visual stylist, and he never got his due. I never saw Angel's Ashes, but he's a guy we haven't really given his due. I think Angel Heart, maybe not this week, but I hope that it finds a home on the show at some point, as I hope Chinatown will.
Well, what about Robert Richardson's work in JFK?
Oh, amazing.
Where he was using multiple formats and film stocks to create, all these different journeys through time and perspective, and, you know, shooting in Super 8 and 16 and 35 and...
Well, hell, why not Zapruder?
I shot in Super 8.
Zapruder. And for that matter, Stone's other Born Killers. He also used, I think he used some video, I mean, all different kinds of crazy film stocks.
And his work for format. Quentin Tarantino. Notice how Quentin's career, his directing style improved so much with Kill Bill. It was such a leap forward once Robert Richardson started shooting his movies. I mean, I love Reservoir Dogs, but it's like really with Kill Bill that it's not only great writing, but like the movies are great cinematically as well. Mm-hmm. And that was Robert Richardson, you know, working with Tarantino. Together, those guys were amazing. And it's the same thing with Inglourious Bastards. I was going to say Trexperts for a second. The same thing with Inglourious Bastards. I mean, you know, And you know, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is stunning.
Yep.
And then, of course, there's a couple of classics like Black Narcissus by Jack Cardiff and Days of Heaven. Nestor Almendros.
Can't do a show about cinematography without mentioning Days of Heaven. But what about The Searchers?
Yeah.
You know, we haven't talked about that or any of John Ford's or any of these classic Westerns. But The Searchers, to me, is like, you know, whatever problems you have with The Searchers, it's too long, it's too racist, it's too this, it's too bad. It's an amazing looking film.
It's an awesome film.
And then and then you've got Baraka, Ron Fricke, or Fricke, I'm not sure how his last name is pronounced, but Fricke, which is shot on 70 millimeter, I believe, and is just, it's not a narrative film. It is a film told in sound and images, and it's spectacular. Right. If you've never seen it, I'd highly recommend checking out Baraka.
From the director of Kronos.
Yes, Kronos. The IMAX Kronos. Not the horror one.
No.
Yeah.
And we haven't talked about any Michael Mann.
From Star Trek VI. No, and Dante Spinetti we haven't talked about.
Yeah.
You know, who did, L.A. Confidential was Dante Spinetti. Mm-hmm. Right. Which is also a beautiful looking movie.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which I just watched last week for the first time in 20 years.
Wow.
Did it hold up? I always loved that movie.
Yeah, it did. I never loved it, but so it held up. I admired it. I liked it, but I didn't love it. And I felt the same way watching it again. It's solid, very solid.
I really like it, other than when it cops out at the end. I really like that movie.
Cops out?
Yeah, that was intentional. Yeah.
We haven't even talked about Pete Potwistle.
No.
I heard Pete Potwistle's a misogynist.
Steve got his mug right there.
He's time with Pete. That's not going to be a
Pete
mug.
Potwistle. No, I don't think it will.
It's our bestseller.
Well, I still would argue for Lawrence Arabia. I understand the concern. So Touch of Evil
I have no problem with choosing Lawrence
Arabia. But you push back on that. So maybe Touch of Evil.
How about Raiders of the Lost Ark? Since they quote the shit out of Lawrence of Arabia and the cinematography.
So does Star Trek V by that excuse.
Yeah.
By
all right, measure. Then let's nominate Star Trek V. There's the shock pick.
By the way, we had Ralph Winter on the Trek Sports last week or 2 weeks ago, and he was just terrific. What great stories about the history of those films. And if you're a film fan and you care at all about the Star Trek films, you should check out Inglourious Trek Sports with Ralph Winter. It was a really, really great episode. It was one of our longest episodes, and we probably could have gone another couple hours.
So it was like a 100 greatest science fiction moments episode. Was that?
Yeah, it was not quite that. Wasn't that long. Michael Chapman for Raging Bull. Okay, maybe not. Okay,
fine. That's good. That's another film that everyone says the best film of the 80s. Yeah, I disagree.
What about Michael Bauhaus for Goodfellas?
Goodfellas.
Oh, we picked that. We picked Goodfellas. Before on the show.
We've picked Goodfellas before.
It's been a friend of ours. We've had it on the show.
I think Casino looks better.
Mm. Oh, yeah. I remember we had this conversation. We had this conversation.
I think that we just have too many choices.
We got to pick. I'm not turning this over to the audience. This is too important.
No, I didn't say to turn over the audience. I said flip a coin.
No Country for Old Men. And then Fargo, which is Deacon's first movie with them.
Yeah. Fargo. Yeah, I think we've picked Fargo.
We have.
Yeah.
Let's go around and see if we can eliminate. So my three would be Lawrence of Arabia, Seven, or Touch of Evil. So now let's go to Darren. What would your three be?
My three would be Blade Runner.
Mm-hmm.
Use your words.
I can't. My mind is going. I can feel
okay,
it.
Okay, we'll come back to you.
Come back.
Ashley, what would your three be?
Lawrence of Arabia, Blade Runner, and Chinatown.
Yeah,
okay. I would have Chinatown on my list too.
Okay. So, Steve, if we were going to go with John Alonzo and Chinatown, how would you feel about that?
The cinematography is great. I have no issue whatsoever.
It's a doctor. You're feeling pain on a scale of 1 to 10.
It's funny. It's good. It's just like, I'm trying to think about it. I, like,
I like Chinatown. It's a masterpiece. The technical, you know, it's great. I just don't like watching it, but it's a perfectly great pick for Cinematography Week.
Relax, Steve. It's the 4:30 movie.
plus, he gets bonus points for actually making Generations slightly watchable because of the cinematography. It's like that movie is so awful. Yeah.
It's but, the only Star you, Trek put a, movie. You put an orange gel on a light and you're a great cinematographer. Awesome.
I don't know. For my money, maybe aside from motion picture, Generations is the only Star Trek movie that looks like a movie to me.
I agree.
Like TV shows.
Looks like a bad movie, but it looks like a movie.
I'm with Steve on that. I have no love for Generations, but I think John Alonso was one of the few redeeming things about that movie. Okay, are we going to go with Chinatown? Is it agreed, John Alonso and Chinatown?
I would love to go with John Alonso and Chinatown.
Sure.
Okay.
Mrs. Mulray, may I present Mr. Giddes?
Mrs. Mulray, how do you do?
My husband, I believe, is seeing another woman. Do you know
me? I think I would have remembered.
Have we ever met?
She tells me she's you. She hires me. Now, whoever put her up to it doesn't have anything against me. They're out to get your husband. If I can see him, I can help him. It's nothing personal, Mrs. Mulray.
It's very personal. It couldn't be more personal.
You've got a nasty reputation, Mr. Gibbs. I like that.
It seems like half the city is trying to cover it all up, which is fine by me. But Mrs. Mulray, I goddamn near lost my nose, and I like it, and I still think that you're hiding something.
I want to know more about you.
You may think you know what you're dealing with, but believe me, you don't.
That's what the district attorney used to tell me in Chinatown.
God, that's great. Wait until we get to It's Music to My Ears Week, and then we can't pick Jerry Goldsmith for Chinatown because we picked
him. Already been picked. Can't pick it again.
Sorry,
God forbid we pick another movie again.
I want to do that. It's Music to My Ears Week. I want to do great scores. Mm. Speaking of which, I just watched Capricorn 1 this weekend.
What a great score.
Oh, great score. So good. So great.
When does Alan come in and tell us we're all on candid camera?
I've never seen Capricorn 1.
Really?
You've never seen Capricorn 1? My kids watched it this weekend and loved it. How could the expert not have seen it? Well, you know, Steve,
we all have our blind spots.
If you don't have the Shout Factory Blu-ray, it's on HBO Max and Prime, Amazon Prime right now. I would highly recommend you watch it.
It's good.
Because in its previous form, it was known as O.J. Simpson versus NASA. But in the current version is Capricorn 1. And it's really terrific. And just out of respect to Hal Holbrook, it's one of his great performances not involving Mark Twain makeup. You should check it out.
And in honor of Barbara Streisand, who sat behind me at a screening of Capricorn 1 and kept talking during the whole movie, telling about how two of her husbands were in the film.
Yeah, because it's Elliot Gould and James Brolin.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Who apparently, I remember you telling me the story. I told the kids this story when we were watching Capricorn 1. And also how James Bond said, "Hey, this movie's pretty good."
Yeah,
that's a great story.
Yeah. Well, guys, this was what a great week, and I mean, so many great picks. We might have to do another cinematography week at some point because we could go on for another a whole month. So, we'll be back next week with an all new 4:30 movie. But before that, I want to ask you guys to recap our picks for this week. Oh, yes. So starting with Steve, Monday.
So Monday is John Alcott's work in Stanley Kubrick's Barry Lyndon.
On Tuesday, Darren, your pick was?
Tuesday is Vittorio Storaro for The Last Emperor.
Wednesday, Ashley Edward Miller's pick.
Luciano Tavoli for Dario Argento's Suspiria.
On Thursday, it's the great John Alton. Directed by Anthony Mann, T-Men. Dun, 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 dun. And on Friday, by mutual consensus, it's John Alonso in the Roman Polanski masterpiece, Chinatown.
We have a week. Wow. We have a week.
What a week. I would watch that week. In fact, watched that week, but not in one week.
I'd watch it again and again.
Except for the T-Men. I haven't seen the T-Men, but I'll watch it.
You got to see the T-Men.
I feel like by the time we got to Saturday, we'd all be like so full of beautiful images, we'd need to take a long nap.
Yes, agreed.
We feel that way anyway. So I think that's just the hazard.
Yeah, no, it's great. But this is great. It's so great to be back with the 4:30 movie. You know, we had a long hiatus, but now we're back. We're in the thick of it now with the fourth season.
Slinging the hits for you.
And I'm so glad to be back here with all of you. And, of course, we're thrilled to be back here with you, our audience. The audience, I'm just thrilled to see every week the show grows in popularity. We really, and you've all been going, I see a lot of you have been going on iTunes and giving us 5 stars, which is terrific. We appreciate it. It's a way to let other people know to listen to the show. And, you know, this was always the also-ran podcast in our lineup, and it has really been doing really well for us. So that's great. And if you want to watch us, you can download the free Electric Now app, and you can watch this podcast along with our other video podcasts, including Cartoon Barroom with Ashley and Steve, Inglourious Trexperts with myself and Darren Dockerman, and more often than not, Ashley Edward Miller, and also the wonderful Best Movies Never Made with Steve Scarlatta and Josh Miller. And you can follow us on the Twitter at 430 Movie Podcast and on Instagram at The 430 Movie. And of course, on Facebook, you can follow us at Electric Surge and also at The 430 Movie. So that's a lot to remember. Write it down. And,
there is a test. Roll it back. Listen to it again.
4271. And so until next Friday, on behalf of Ashley, Steve, Darren, and myself, I'm going to say a very special thank you to our sound engineers, the great Bill Ritter, along with our associate sound engineer, Mark Rivera, our associate producers, Zach Raggetts and Peter Holmstrom, our producer, Natalie Miscali, and our audience for always being there to listen and learn, hopefully, and yell at your phone or your car and say, what is with these lunatics? What are they thinking? How'd they miss all this stuff? Anyway, we'll see you next Friday. Until then, Eyewitness News starts now.
This show is produced by Dean Devlin and Mark A. Altman and is an Electric Surge Network production.